Well, amen, 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 amen. That is one of my favorite songs. I'm just so happy. Thank you. That sister can sing, and when I get to heaven, I pray that I'll be able to sing like her. First, I just want to say I am excited and I am delighted to be back with the Wilsdon Seventh-day Adventist Church. Shout out to Pastor Mario for allowing me to be on his around his pulpit, so to speak. Thank you, my pastor. I pray that God will continue to bless your ministry. And to my good friend, Elder Keith Allen, we go way back. As a matter of fact, this October will be 6 years since I was actually at your great congregation, and what a time we had. That if you remember, if you care to remember, that season was a little bit difficult for me as my senior pastor passed away. But you, Wilsdon, took me through it through your prayers and support and gave me ground provision. And so I'm grateful. I will never forget Wilsdon. You will always be a part of my heart. And thank you so much. Yes, the elder is right. Someone had grace on me and decided that that they wanted to join me and be a part of my life. And so I am grateful for my wife, who is resting right now, who is resting because it's still very early in the morning. And I always say that only two people could get me up early, two people who could get me up so early in the morning to preach, and that is Wilsdon and another brother by the name of Pastor Warren Gillen. So we praise God for Wilsdon, and we pray that we would continue to grow. God has a word for us. He has a word for us. And I'm really, if I get a little bit excited, please don't get mad at me. Don't tune me out. I know that some of you are still in bed. You're not in church clothes, but please try and pay attention. God has a word for us on today. And so it comes to us from the book of Matthew chapter 16, Matthew 16. And I'm inviting you to find it, verse 15 through to 23, Matthew 16, verses 15 to 23. And I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version. And trust me, God has something that he wants to say. And so Matthew 16, 15 reads thus. He saith unto them, But whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say unto thee, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail rather against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loose in heaven. Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day. Then Peter, watch this, y'all. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him. I'm going to read it again because I said that too fast. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, Be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. And, but he turned and said unto Peter, Get thee behind me. Get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. It is about to go down like four flat tires. And I hope, Wesleyan, you're ready, because I am ready. If I were at your, if I were in your building, I would tell you to turn to your neighbor, but we're living in this era of social distancing. So do me a favor, do me a favor. I'm going to give you permission to take out your phones or just text somebody. Or if you're on Facebook, just put it in the chat or on YouTube and help me preach my little sermon. And it's entitled, y'all ready for this? It is entitled, I'm Still Not Clear. I'm Still Not Clear. Yeah, I'm still not clear. Pray with me. Father, we ask for the next little while that you would be on the increase and that I would be on the decrease. Please, God, flex your muscles. Please allow us to feel your awesome presence. I'm in New Jersey, there in over there in London, but the same God that blesses us here in the U.S. can bless them all the way in England or wherever they are, all parts of the world. We pray that you would have your way. Please, God, don't allow me to stand in the way of the sermon. Just speak, because we all are listening. And then please, let the words of my mouth and my heart's meditation be pleasing in your divine sight, because you're our strength and redeemer. And we say amen and amen. I'm still not clear. I've got a question that I've got to ask you, Wilsden, and everybody else who's watching. And here it is. Can you walk with God? Can you walk with God in the blurry places? I say, can you walk with God in the blurry places? When life is out of focus, can you still be faithful? And I'll be the first to declare and decree on this, on today, that I'm living in a season right now where I have a lot more questions than I do answers. I know that you all are spiritual and saved, and so you are all clear, but I'm still not clear. I've got questions like, will our children be able to go to school and do it safely? I've got questions like, will the church doors be open anytime soon? I know some of you all are enjoying this season, getting up, but not really getting up, and just enjoying church from your homes. But I'm kind of tired of this. I know church is still happening, but I need the doors to be opened as well. I've got a lot of questions. If you live in the U.S., you've got this great question: who's going to win this election? Are we going to have another four more years of this president? I've got a lot of questions. Questions like, will the virus be gone away next year this time? I've got some questions. Perhaps this is your question: will I still have a job, because things are not looking up right now? I'm being honest. I've got a lot of questions. It's all blurry to me. And this morning or this afternoon, I want to talk about being in the blurred stage. Yeah. I want to talk about the blurred stage. The blurred stage is the dichotomy of two conditions and not neither. It is not quite sight, but it is not quite blind. It has too much sight to be blind, but too much blindness to be sighted. Oh, I'm preaching already. It's the stage where people stop helping you because you can see, but you can't help yourself because you can't see as good as you need to. And in this chapter that we've just read, the church is in a blurred state. Jesus raises a question that leads them there. He says, who do men say that I am? And the church's response tells me that they are in a blurred state because they cannot agree about Jesus. The church is not sure about itself. The church seems to be out of sync. They're going back and forth until a man named Peter, thank God for Peter, he says, I know who you are. Jesus says, who? Peter says, thou art the Christ, the Son of the true and living God. God. This is one of the most amazing moments in scripture because Jesus now says, flesh and blood did not reveal it unto you, but my Father which is in heaven. For Peter to know that Jesus was the Christ was just amazing. And so being a crit, being the kind of person that I am, I'm very inquisitive. You all know that I'm very inquisitive. And so I had to ask the text some questions. And so I'm like, how did Peter know that Jesus was the Christ while the other disciples were doubtful? How did Peter know with some sort of certainty that Jesus was the Christ? I'm so glad you asked. After all, if you remember just two chapters prior, in Matthew 14, all of the disciples were in a tumultuous storm and all of them were afraid. You all know your Bibles. Jesus comes on the scene and then they say they thought that it was a duppy. I'm sorry. They thought that it was a ghost. And Jesus says, don't be afraid. And he says, don't be afraid, it is I. And he permits Peter to walk on water. And they both catch gravity by surprise, and they're walking on water. But at the end of the story, the wind ceases and the disciples cry out. They say, you really are the Son of God. But now two chapters later, when they are asked the same question, who do men say that I am? They are in a blurred state. Can I tell you the difference between the disciples and Peter that night? Why Peter was so sure that Jesus was the Christ and the disciples now were so unsure. That night, if you remember, Peter was the only one that was drowning. Okay, 1, 2, 3, got it, okay? I said Peter was the only one that was drowning that night. And watch what Peter says as he is drowning. He says, Lord, save me. He doesn't cry out Elijah or John the Baptist, but Lord, save me. When the Lord lifted him up out of what was trying to kill him that night, and did what he asked him to do, there was no doubt in Peter's mind that Jesus was the Son of the living God. And when you have experienced the grace of God for yourself, when he takes you out of a personal situation that was way over your head and he saves you, then you can speak with some kind of conviction. Somebody knows what I'm talking about, because God has lifted you out of some stuff that you should have drowned in. You should have drowned in depression. You should have drowned in suicidal thoughts. You should have drowned in loneliness. You should have drowned in unemployment. After all that you've been through, you should have drowned in this corona season. But he lifted you up and he allowed you to walk on what should have killed you. And now you know that Jesus is Lord. Is there anybody who can testify and say, I know for myself? I don't need somebody to tell me, the pastors to tell me, or the elders. I know him for my, as a matter of fact, I've tasted and I can testify that the Lord, he is good. Is there anybody here who doesn't mind worshiping him online? You know without a shadow of doubt that Jesus is Lord, that he's your way maker. He's a miracle. Oh, y'all are getting me excited already. He's a promise keeper. He's the light in the darkness. You can't speak for anybody else, but you've seen for yourself that Jesus is good. And so here it is. Jesus says, Peter, now you are the rock, and the gates of hell will never be able to prevail against it. But hold up, wait a minute, Peter. I'm so sorry to press the pause on the celebration, because while the church was in a blurred state, we see that Peter was in a blurred state as well. How is that, preacher? I'm so glad you asked. Now, we just read the story And you'll realize that even though Peter was clear about Jesus being the Christ, he was not clear about Jesus going to the cross too fast. I got you. Let me back that. Let me reverse. Let me say it again. That while Peter was clear about Jesus being the Christ, he was not clear about Jesus going to the cross. He was in a blurred stage on that issue to the point where Peter gets rebuked by Jesus. And the question is, how could Peter be so clear that he could make the connection that Jesus was the Christ, but be blind to the cross? But I'm learning, Wilsden, and everybody else who is watching, that you can be clear in one area and then be totally blind in another. Preach, phrase. The stress of our life is not coming from blindness nor brightness. The stress of our life comes from the blurredness. It's about being clear about this, but being blind about that. And when it came to the cross, Jesus called him a devil. He says, "Get behind me, Satan, because thou savor not the things of God." But wait a minute. I'm wondering if I'm reading my Bible correctly. Jesus calls him, here it is, oh Lord. Jesus just called Peter a rock. But in this verse, Jesus calls him Satan. Have mercy. What's going on in the text? I had to take a double look because I'm saying, am I seeing this really correctly? How can in one verse he can be called a rock and the gates of hell will never be able to prevail against it? In another verse, Jesus says, get thee behind me, Satan. But the lesson that is being taught is this, that you can be a rock in one area of your life and be devilish in another. Ooh, preach, phrase. I'm doing the best I can. In the same story, the rock and the devil are sitting in the same man. In the same story, he's a rock about this, but he's devilish about that. Yeah. And I know that you all are perfect. I know that you've got your T's crossed and your I's dotted. And so some of you cannot relate to this, but there are a few of us who can be honest enough to say that while you're righteous about this, you're wrong about that. Yeah. Yeah. While you're spiritual over here, you're carnal over there. Yeah. Yeah. While you're strong about being vegan, you're weak in the area of gossiping. I know that some of you may not like this. While you're faithful in keeping the Sabbath, you're faulty when it comes on to being compassionate. And that's why you can't judge anybody else, because we all have blurred areas. You're not clear on everything. You're just one step away from blindness. And how can I be so bright in the workplace and be so blind in my home life? How can I be so bright when I write, but so blind when I talk? Because we've got two realities living in a singular situation, and it's only by the grace of God. It's because of his mercies. While we are not consumed, they are new every morning. Is there anybody who can testify, who can write in that chat, "Great is thy faithfulness"? And I'm so glad that God's mercy is new every morning, because I mess up every day. Okay, y'all are perfect, but there are some of us who can testify that we mess up every single day, and yesterday's grace is not sufficient for today's sins. I need brand new mercies, not stale mercies, but brand new mercies. That's the kind of God that we serve. And I'm so glad that while there is so much sin, while sin abounds, grace abounds much more. Is there anybody thankful that he does not treat us as our sin deserves? deserves. Is there anybody thankful that while we were yet sinners, Jesus came in and stepped in for? Is there anybody here? Am I the only one who's excited and who's grateful for the grace of God? Because it had it not been for God's grace, had it not been for what he did on Calvary, I don't know where any of us would be. Somebody ought to shout online that God is faithful. And while we are not clear about everything, and so that's why we cannot judge anybody else, because we all have blurred areas in our life. Yeah, yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. So here is the question. Oh, I heard a song a couple weeks ago, God's grace will always be greater than sin. That's a shout right there. I said, God's grace will always be greater than sin. Okay, and so here is the main question. See, I'm getting hot. I'm getting hot. Here's the main question that I had to ask the text. How can I handle the blurred areas of my life? How can I handle the blurred areas when I'm not clear? What do I do? Here's my first point. Neil deGrasse Tyson couldn't have said it any better, so I'm going to quote him. How do I handle the blurred areas of my life when things are not clear? Here it is. He says, the greatest challenge of life, this is about to get good. The greatest challenge of life is knowing enough to think you're right, but not knowing enough to know you are wrong. Oh, I feel like preaching. That's so good. And when things are, that's so nice. And when things are nice, you ought to say them twice. So I'm going to say it again. Here it is. He says, understand that greatest challenge of life is knowing enough to think you're right, but not knowing enough to know that you are wrong. Peter thought that he knew and understood the role and function of the Messiah to the point where the Bible says that he pulls Jesus. Now, you know, can we talk? You know that Peter's not seeing clearly when he starts to pull Jesus over. He starts to pull Jesus to the side. In my experience as a pastor, when someone pulls you to the side, when they want to talk to you, you know it's not something good. Peter pulls Jesus to the side, and watch what he does, y'all. The Bible says he rebukes Jesus. I said, Peter, the one who is created, he rebukes the creator. And when you start correcting Jesus, you know you got a problem. Scholars say that the disciples had come to their fullest realization that Jesus was the central figure toward whom all history pointed. This revelation, when they finally figured out that Jesus was the Christ, they thought they had everything that they needed to know. They thought that they knew everything just because they got this revelation that Jesus was the Messiah. A little revelation can get to some people's heads. A little education can cause some people to think that they know it all. And I don't know if you've ever met anyone like this, who they speak like they know everything, like there isn't anything new that you can tell them. These kinds of people drive me crazy. But deep down, there is an insecurity that says, I have to be right. I have to know this because what you think of me is extremely important. You see, we love to unlock the door to our success. We love to show people what we're good at. And as long as you need what we're good at, then come on in. But if you have a need where I'm not good, that's when my walls go up. And we never understand, I'm teaching now, that it is our uncertainty that is the attraction. Ah, that's so good. I said, we don't understand that it is our uncertainty that is the attraction. We think that we need to be invincible, but Jesus said, they that are not sick, they don't need a physician. And the more that you try to impress people, the more you hide your uncertainty, the more you try to be fake, phony, and fictitious and disguise your uncertainty, the less your blessing will be, because arrogance always destroys opportunity. preach, praise. I'm doing the best I can, and I'm preaching better than y'all responding. It's a common mistake to think that, it's a common mistake that we've been making for years. It still shocks me to this day that we haven't learned the blessing of saying, I can't, show me how, I don't know how, teach me. It's when you become vulnerable and say, I'm not there yet, that is the portal of revelation. That is the nectar of human experience. That is the attraction that draws the teacher to sit with the student. But you disguise your uncertainty with arrogance and lose the opportunity for revelation. And you are stuck on the journey because you are more concerned about your pride than you are productivity. Ah, Fraser. Yeah, I'm preaching. That's why I like the blind man in Mark chapter 8. Jesus touched him, but he still could not see clearly. Y'all remember that? You all know your Bibles. He was still in a blurred stage. Jesus said to him in Mark 8, do you see anything? And so the man says, I see men as tall as trees. Ah, he was in a blurred stage. Do you know how much courage it took for that blind man to say to Jesus in front of all his disciples that your touch didn't fix me? It's the only case in the scriptures where the touch didn't get the full and complete immediate results. And what I like about this man was that he did not act like he could see more than he could see, that he knew more than he actually knew. Here it is. If this man lied about how well he could see, he would have never been made whole. What got him healed was not so much his faith, it was his honesty. Fraser, it was the courage to say, I'm better than where I was, but I'm nowhere where I need to be. I'm in a blurred stage right now. See, the devil doesn't want you to be honest. He wants you to be impressive. He wants you to walk around with your chest stuck out, guarding your reputation, making people think that you are more than you are. But the Bible says, if you humble yourself, God will exalt you. If you come down off your high horse, God will raise you up. If you admit that you can't see as you would like, God says, I will give you a second touch, but I will only give it to an honest person. So he says, because of your honesty, blind man or blurred man, because you didn't try to impress people, because you didn't try to be more than what you are, because you humbled yourself, even though you were in a crowd, because you told the truth, even though it made you look bad, because you were honest enough to admit that you don't have it all together, guess what? I'm going to give you a second release of grace. I'm going to finish what I started. Your latter days will be greater than your former days. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but if you come clean and be humble, the Lord will take you out of that blurred state. Stop caring about what people think and get your touch from God. This has nothing to do with anybody else. This doesn't have anything to do with the church. This doesn't have anything to do with people, your family, but you need to see God for yourself. And so here it is. Whenever you're in a blurred state, you've got to remember that, yeah, you don't know everything. You don't know everything. You do not know. I need to read that phrase again. You don't know everything. That you knowing enough, you got to remember that the greatest challenge of life is knowing enough to think you're right, but not knowing enough to know you are wrong. You've got to humble yourself and be honest. Then the second thing, I'm almost done. My second point is, my second point, stop making definitive statements while you're in a blur. Let me say that again, because that was too good. Stop making definitive statements while you're in a blur. Peter says in the Greek, I'm in the text. He says, Jesus, never. This will never happen to you. You're never going to die. You're never going to suffer. You're not going to this cross. Peter is way over his head in making this statement after Jesus told him. Read the story again. Jesus just told him that he was going to die, that he was going to the cross. And Peter is telling Jesus it's not going to happen to him. Isn't it crazy how some people can make definitive statements over your life like they know more than what you know, like they're the ones in charge? It was obvious that Peter is not seeing clearly, and making definitive statements while you're in a blur will mess you up. I've seen people kill their future by making a decision when they're in a blurred stage, because here it is, you'll be surprised at what you can't tell. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Some weeks ago, because I knew I was coming to Wilson, so I had to come with an illustration. I had to do a physical, and I didn't remember that when you're doing a physical, it includes an eye exam. And so I left my glasses in my car, and quite frankly, I didn't think that I needed them. I really don't even need them right now. I just have them on because I look like studious and you all will think that I'm smarter. So I didn't think that I needed my glasses after all. I could see her. I could see what color she was. But as we began to move through the test, oh Lord have mercy, the details became blurry. I couldn't see those small letters because I was in a blurred stage, and for preaching and driving, I can see, but those small letters, those fine details, I couldn't see it. I think someone knows what I'm talking about. But do you know that every time that you make a decision in a blurred stage, you're trying to read those small letters with your glasses off? Oh, have mercy. I mean, I was struggling. I thought I saw a T, but it was a D. I mean, it was the worst. And I'm realizing that every time that you try to make a decision, you make a definitive move in a blurred stage, you're really trying to read those small letters without your glasses. And as a result, you live in a blur, and everything is blurry. Some of you got divorced in a blur. Yeah. Some of you got married in a blur. Some of you have left cities, moved out of homes in a blur, walked away from a job in a blurred state. Some of us have been leading ministries from a blurred stage, singing in church and preaching and teaching in a blurred stage. The Bible says, now we see through a glass darkly and then face to face. I have learned the decisions. I have learned the dangers of making decisions in the blur. And so that's when I said, doctor, let me go get my glasses. She said, doggone it, you wear glasses? I said, yes. And when I came back, can I preach like I feel it? When I came back with my glasses, what I struggled to see before, I could now see clearly. I realized that wasn't the letter C, but it was the letter E. Somebody knows what that feels like. After God gave you the glasses of spiritual discernment, you realize that you were wrong about that decision. Yeah, that relationship wasn't right for you. Yeah, you should have ran quicker. You should have left the job a long time ago. You should have had on your spiritual glasses. Someone knows what I'm talking about. Yet you need your spiritual glasses in order to discern what God has for you. So put on your spiritual glasses. And but the other reason, here it is, why we shouldn't make definitive statements in a blur. I'm almost done. Is because sometimes what we need determines what we see. Oh man. No, I'm really preaching. My voice is going out, but I'm still preaching. Yeah, when we want something to be true, we often see what we want to see. Our need can truly color our judgment. And in the text, scholars tell us that even though the suffering of the Messiah was foretold in the Old Testament, here it is, the Jews did not know what to do with these prophecies. They could see the Messiah as triumphant because they wanted to be free from Roman oppression. The idea of a suffering savior was rejected by them because this is not what they needed. They needed a liberator. And the implications of him suffering would mean that they would have to suffer too. Oh, they wanted no part in that. But just because you need something to be true doesn't mean that it is. And where we start needing something to be true, the danger is that we can make it look better than it actually is. Ooh, and we omit data that might be staring us in the face. Some of us have made, oh, that is so good. I may need to say that again, that when we need something to be true, that we can actually make it look better than it actually is. And we omit data that might be staring us in the face. Some of us might have made some serious commitments, and now you're thinking, had I known that this was what it was, I would have never gone there. I would have saved myself. But could it be that it was always there, but your desires distorted your objectivity? Ooh, I'm getting in trouble. Oh, Phrase, you're really doing it. Yeah, Holy Spirit, we're doing this thing. But could it be that she was always like that, my brother? Could it be that the job was always that way? Could it be that the house always had termites? Could it be, sis, that dude was always immature? Could it be that she always liked to spend money? Could it be because things did not just change overnight? Is there anybody who can be honest enough to say, Pastor, that was me? My eyes prevented me from seeing. Yeah. And I'm tired of thinking that I found someone who was solid gold only to discover that there were only strong aluminum foil. Yeah. I'm tired of fool's gold. Is someone ready to say, Lord, help me to see what you need me to see so I can save myself some drama, save myself from sleepless nights, save myself from medication, from depression? Because at the end of the day, Jesus did not come for me to live in misery, but he came so that I may have life and have it more abundantly. Is there anybody that wants what God has for them? But here it is, and my final point, and I'm done. What I love about the text, everybody, is that God's revelation was better than the disciples' reality. Oh, I'm going to say that again. What I love about the text is that God's revelation was better than the disciples' reality. All this time, the disciples were so focused on Jesus' death that they failed to see that Jesus said he would be raised back to life. Jesus said it right there in the text that on the third day, I wish I had a church, he would be raised. And when you begin to see clearly, you see the entire picture, and that changes your perspective. I'm about to close this thing. I need you all to help me close this thing. But at my church, in my church, we have lost a lot of members in such a short span of time. We've lost about 4 members, and this last member who we lost, it was devastating because she was young and she died from cancer, and it was horrific. It was horrific. I mean, the church is still in mourning as a result of her passing. But then I remembered what happened a few weeks ago. She had called me and she said, Pastor, I need you to come and visit me. And so I'm like, hey, but this is still the COVID season. She said, Pastor, I need you to come and visit me. I want you to remember what I'm talking about. When you're able to see clearly, you see the entire picture and your perspective changes. And so now I say, all right. So I go down to see her. And so she says, Pastor, I want you to know I am going to Jamaica for a month. And I'm saying, really, you want to go to Jamaica for a month? Because she told me that the cancer had spread. And so I'm saying, you really want to go? And she said, Pastor, I'm going to Jamaica for a month. I said, all right, I can't stop you, sis, but here's what I need you to do. I need you to come back to New Jersey. I need you enjoy your time in Jamaica, eat breadfruit, eat what you need to enjoy. And just, I don't even know if it's breadfruit season, but just eat that and come back and we'll hang out again. She said, Pastor, I promise you that I will see you again. I said, all right. And so she called, she flew out to Jamaica. And so while she was in Jamaica, she reached out to me. She said, hey, Pastor, I've got down here safely. I am well. I'm doing well. I'm in a little pain, but I'm all right. And so I said, all right. I said, do you remember? I remember what I said. I said, you know, you need to come back to New Jersey. And she said, Pastor, I promise I will see you again. And then I was beginning to wonder how come she could speak with so much conviction and so much purpose. The Holy Spirit and so much conviction that she would see me again. The Holy Spirit then revealed to me that she had the total picture, because while you thought she was coming back to New Jersey, she already knew that she would not see you in New Jersey, but she would see you in the New Jerusalem. She had the entire picture. And so it all made sense to me now. And because when you have the entire picture, you can smile when you have cancer. When you have the entire picture, you can smile when you lose a loved one. When you have the entire picture, you can get through this COVID season without worrying about a job. When you have the entire picture, you can smile in your storm. When you have the entire picture, you don't mind even when death comes, because when the entire picture shows us that in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, that we shall be changed. I don't know who I'm preaching to, who you lost someone in this season, because the Bible tells me, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a loud shout, with the voice of the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise. Oh, I cannot wait. We will declare, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? So here are my final words, Wilsden. Cheer up, ye pilgrims. Be joyful and sing. Jesus is coming again. No more tears, no more sorrow, no more pain, no more crying. One day we'll see him face to face, and oh, that will be, I feel my help coming. Glory for me when by his grace I shall look on his face. That will be glory. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but someone needs to hear this word, that trouble will not last always. For he that shall come will come and will not tarry. Weeping will endure for a night. But joy, I said, but joy comes in the morning. Hold on, Wilsden. Jesus is coming again. And so that's what I want to leave. That's what I want to leave with you. I've kept you for too long, that you can trust God's unchanging hand. He is faithful, y'all. He is so faithful. He is so faithful. And even though we may not see things clearly right now, if we hang on to him, we will. Perhaps today you've heard this word, you're not clear, and you need some clarity. You want to be able to see things. You want to be able to get out of this blur stage. Then I invite you just to reach out to Wilsden. Go on the website. Send a message to Pastor Mario, send a message to the elders, whomever, and just say, hey, I need to be on the blur stage. out of this blurred stage. Make your decision. Make your stand for him right now. God wants you to see clearly so that you can get what he has for you. Don't walk around here. Walk around living in a blurred stage. That's not what God has for you. And so if this person is you, why don't you just type in the chat on Facebook, on YouTube, whatever, just say, Pastor, that's me. Pray for me. Pastor, that's me. Pastor, that's me. Shall we pray? God, we need you now more than ever. Things aren't clear. There are so many uncertainties. Help us, God, not to make a definitive decision. Help us only to walk in the divine purpose that you have called for us. Bless each worshiper under the sound of my voice. I don't know what their struggles, their strains are, but you know. Meet them where they are so that they won't stumble over those things which the enemy sets in their way. Thank you for hearing. Thank you for answering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. Thank you.